The CBS Radio Mystery Theater presents...
Come in. Welcome. I'm E.G. Marshall. What is it about the weather or temperature that seems to control the mind? We stiffen and grow sluggish in winter, and in tropical heat, we almost lose our power of reasoning. But is it only the heat that mesmerizes the minds of those in the mystery we're about to unfold? Has matter conquered mind? The climate caused madness? Or are we about to explore a power far worse, the power of evil?
Artie, I tell you, my luck is changing. I'm winning every bet I place.
You are such a sucker, Jack, it's not to be believed. The odds are always with the bank. No one wins at that casino.
Maybe, but I've got a system.
Yeah, who's bankrolling you? You haven't a dime.
A lady I met there.
Oh, Jack, she may be just a gambling partner to you, but women don't gamble to lose.
Our mystery drama, The Power of Evil, was written especially for the Mystery Theater by James Agate, Jr., and stars Lloyd Battista. It is sponsored in part by True Value Hardware Stores and Contac, the 12-hour cold capsule. I'll be back shortly with Act One. A certain power that works against the throw of the dice, the spin of the wheel, the shuffle of cards, the long shot. Where best to examine this power but at one of the wide open gambling towns known throughout the world, Macau, the Portuguese province, across the South China Sea from Hong Kong, and who best to dare the fates but a certain gentleman sitting at a roulette table in Macau casino, Jack Pante. He plays... and he perspires.
Bisset, Rouge, and Père Monk. 17.
There goes the ball game.
And
my shirt. I beg your pardon. What is it? What do you want?
Are you talking to me?
Well, you've been standing behind my back all evening.
Watching you losing.
Well, don't you have anything better to do, lady? Go stand somewhere else.
Well, maybe I can help you.
The best way you can help is just go away.
Are you going to play some more?
With what?
Stand up here. No more betting, please.
I'm getting out of here.
May I come with you?
I don't see how I can stop you.
Let's go have a drink.
I'd like to, but I've just enough left to buy my ticket on the gambler's ferry back to Hong Kong.
Well, since I may have been responsible for your losing streak, let me buy you a drink.
Fair enough. I don't know how responsible you were. Besides, are you that superstitious?
I believe in all the things about life and death no one has been able to explain.
Meaning?
When fate takes a hand, all you can do is follow.
Well, I've been having rotten luck at gambling for weeks, months.
Do you come to the Lisboa Casino often? I can't remember seeing you.
Look, I'll drink with you, okay? But I'd rather not talk with you. Do you mind?
You're upset. Thank goodness I don't insult easily. Besides, supposing I staked you. I have money.
You?
Agnes Keith. Miss Agnes Keith.
Oh, I'm Jack Pante. I apologize. I think I deserve a good slap in the face for being so rude to you.
Why should I mind, Jack? You and I are going to be very good friends.
Agnes Keith was 15 years older than I. She'd never been married. She had lots of money, and she lived in Hong Kong since she was a child. I worked for the American Consul in Hong Kong. Not one of the top jobs, but one of the real boring, shuffling paper-type jobs. So whenever I could, I'd make the hydrofoil to Macau and gamble. That's where most of my salary went.
Jack, what's with you? I mean, it's been weeks now. We used to bowl at the American Club every Saturday. I never see you there anymore.
Artie, you won't believe it, but my luck's changing.
Don't tell me you've been transferred back to Washington.
I said my luck's changed, not my dreams come true. I'm winning, Artie.
At what?
Roulette. Every bet I place.
Jack, you are such a sucker, it's not to be believed. Don't you know the odds are against anyone coming out ahead at the casinos in Macau?
Not if you use a method. I play the grind.
Yeah, I know all about those systems. And the reverse martingale and the Biarritz. You'll get sucked in and then blown away.
So far I've had maximum action with minimum bankroll.
Yeah, so far. And who's bankrolling you between paydays?
A lady, I meant.
I see. And this lady is staking you. Now, be careful, Jack. A woman never plays to lose.
Excuse me. Hello.
Hello, Jack.
Yes, Agnes.
Can you get off early today in time to catch the ferry to Macau? I have a great new system to try out.
Just a minute. Hey, Artie, I want to catch the 4 o'clock hydrofoil to Macau. Can you cover for me until about 5:30?
Today? Why can't you wait till the weekend?
Ah, come on. I'd do the same for you.
I don't think it's smart of you. But, okay.
Thanks, pal. Agnes?
What's the trouble, dear?
I'll meet you at the dock in time to catch the 4 o'clock.
I knew you'd come, Jack, darling.
Okay, I'll be there.
What is all this, Jack? It can't just be money.
Come on, cut it out. She's much older than I am. I don't have any romantic interest in this woman.
Maybe so, but what about her? Remember what I said, Jack. She may be only a gambling partner to you, but women don't often gamble to lose.
What are you talking about?
Someday, somehow, she'll want her money's worth.
That night at the casino, Agnes and I tried out a new system, and I won $500. We had quite a few drinks to celebrate. The next night, we'd be back and make even bigger bets. And at 4 o'clock in the morning, when the gambler's ferry took us back to Hong Kong, she sprung it on me. Agnes made it very plain. She wasn't just putting up money to spin the wheel. Her stakes were higher. She wanted me to marry her.
You look terrible this morning, Jack. I told you, you can't keep those late hours and do the job you're being paid for.
You were right about her, Artie.
Numbers wasn't her only racket, hmm?
She proposed marriage to me Friday on the ferry home. Oh, boy, I was flabbergasted.
You're an idiot. What did you say?
Well, I told her no. A flat no, never. What else could I say?
And she took it just like that?
Not exactly. She has funny reactions to things. She made me promise to see her one more time.
Sure. Can't we talk it over? You dimwit.
Look, I'm being as nice about this as I can. I don't want to hurt her. Well, all she's asked is to ride up to her estate with her in a rickshaw.
She is strange.
Why do you say that?
Think she'll change her mind in a rickshaw? Like making major decisions in a phone booth.
You haven't seen this one, Artie. It's much bigger, like one of those old-fashioned palanquins. It's about 8 feet long, 4 feet wide, carries 2 people easily. She's got 4 coolies who carry it. She goes everywhere in it.
Yeah, I've seen some of those big old rickshaws. Some customs the Chinese never give up.
But her folks were American, not Chinese. Well, they're dead now. I think her father was a missionary who went into the import business. This rickshaw's been in the family for years. Beautiful old thing, painted bright yellow.
And you're planning to ride around tonight with a woman you've broken off with?
Well, what could I do? She's very persistent. I said I'd meet her at the bottom of Kowloon Hill. And she'll be waiting for me.
You keep that date, Jack, and it's not over. It's just beginning.
Yeah. Yeah, maybe you're right. She's got this funny hold over me. I don't know what it is, but it's getting stronger and stronger, and Well, I don't like it. Not one bit.
Jack? Jack, darling, over here.
Hello, Agnes. Oh, wow, this is a first for me, Agnes. I've never ridden one of these old rickshaws before.
Come on, climb in.
Ooh, beautiful paint job. That's some yellow.
Some of the old Chinese families in Hong Kong have had their big rickshaws for years. I like keeping up the old customs. Look at my coolies. But don't stare. See how they're dressed in matching yellow waistbands? My idea. Come on, step up. There's plenty of room.
Well, not bad. Oh, comfortable.
Hold on. Here we go.
Whoa! Your boy has really lifted this thing up fast.
You'll get used to it. It's a lovely way to ride. Now, Jack, darling, I don't want you to say anything. Let me talk. That very first day at the roulette table, I knew we'd be great friends. I said so, remember?
Agnes, I'm very sorry if I made you feel I had any more than, well, a casual interest in you.
Even a friendship?
What's the use?
But you can't mean that. I know that in your heart...
Now, you don't know what's in my heart. How could you? Now, will you stop talking like that?
Why, Jack?
Look, you and I... Well, it isn't supposed to be anything, and it wasn't anything. I won some money because you staked me. I paid you back. That's all it was.
No, Jack. We are going to be friends and more. Forever.
Now, I never gave you reason to believe that.
Don't make me angry, darling.
What is that? A pistol?
Yes, Jack. Now, you will listen quietly, and I will tell you what you will do.
Agnes, please, just... put that thing away. Well, of course we can be friends.
Do you mean that? Are you being honest with me?
Just give me the gun. Just hand it to me.
Oh, no, not so fast. I want a solemn promise. An unbreakable promise.
Give it here.
Let go of me, Jack. Jack. It's all a mistake.
What have I done?
Someday, dearest Jack, we... shall be together.
I leapt out of the rickshaw. The coolies stood together, no expression on their faces, like wax figures. I ran as fast as I could down Kowloon Hill. I turned, and up there in the moonlight, I could still see the yellow rickshaw. I could swear I still heard her voice. I woke up. It was morning. Had I been dreaming at all? Had that pearl-handled gun really gone off? Was it true? Did it happen, or was it a nightmare? When I got to the office, I found out.
It's a good thing you didn't keep your date with that Agnes Keith.
Hey, how did you know her last name?
It's plastered all over the Hong Kong Times. You haven't seen it?
No, I overslept. Came right to the office.
Well, she was found this morning on Kowloon Hill in her yellow rickshaw, shot through the head. Suicide.
How do they know?
She was holding a pistol, pearl-handled. It's been identified as hers.
I don't suppose anyone saw it happen or heard the shot.
Not so far as I know. Her coolies had run away. You'd never find them.
How horrible.
Thought he had a system to win at roulette. He won for a time, but he seems to be losing in the game of life. That strange woman in her yellow rickshaw, now stained with her blood. Has Jack seen the last of her? Our bet is that he hasn't. So join us for the payoff when I return shortly with Act Two. That roulette was invented hundreds of years ago by a Benedictine monk. It took him 20 years to perfect it, and then he tried to find a way to beat his invention. He wanted to win enough money gambling to buy a new bell for the monastery. 10 years he searched for that winning system. It eluded him. He went mad and hung himself. There's an equation here between gambling and death. But I'm not sure yet that Jack Pante realizes it.
As the months passed, the memory of Agnes Keith and the strange grip she seemed to have on my life loosened, lessened. I quite persuaded myself that the pistol had gone off accidentally, but I wasn't to blame. For me, once again, life was on an even keel. Then one Friday, a beautiful girl came into the office and asked for Artie.
Kitty!
Arthur, darling! Oh, how are you? You look wonderful.
Kitty, this is Jack Pante.
I thought I knew everything about Artie, but you're a prize surprise.
Shall we tell him, Arthur?
No, not just yet. Let him worry a while.
Is this the Jack Pante you wrote me about?
The one and only. Yep. Kitty's just come over from the States. Since my mother and father have passed away, I don't have any home to go on home leave for, so I traded Kitty's fare here for mine there.
Oh, well, I wish you every happiness, you two.
Why don't you join us? I thought we might show Kitty the sights.
Well, don't you two want to be alone?
Arthur, I think we ought to tell him.
Did you say alone? Why would anybody want to be alone with his sister?
Kitty is your sister. You old son of a gun. Hey, that's great.
Oh, it's unbelievable. Oh, where's the time gone?
Well, it sure doesn't seem as though you've been here for only a month. It may be corny, but it's true, Kitty. I feel as if I've known you all my life.
Well, we've seen each other practically every day since I came to Hong Kong. My idea was to visit my brother.
Well, I don't think he minds.
Well, I've got to think about going home sometime. Oh, but I love this part of the world.
And there it is. The whole city at your feet.
Being way up here on Victoria Peak just takes my breath away.
Kit. What takes my breath away? Well, it isn't the altitude. You know that.
I know, Jack. I feel the same way.
We've had some wonderful times. Is there any reason why it shouldn't go on?
None that I can see.
Will you marry me, Kit?
Oh, I thought you'd never ask.
What's that?
Darling, what's the matter?
Over there. Behind those tall trees.
Well, I don't see anything.
Oh, you don't?
No. No, I don't. But there is something, Jack.
Something? What?
Well, it's funny. When you were holding me just now, I felt as if somebody was watching us.
She hadn't seen it. Kitty hadn't seen anything unusual up there on the top of Victoria Peak. But I had. Agnes Keith's big yellow rickshaw. And the same four coolies wearing the same wide yellow sashes. Oh, who had brought Agnes's rickshaw there? What was it doing there?
Now, sir, what do you and the little lady fancy?
Well, we're looking for an engagement ring and a wedding ring.
Oh, you came right place. I show you this tray. Very fine value. Look, I hold up to the light. See how the solitaire sparkles? Blue-white, very fine.
May I try it on?
Oh, certainly, certainly. Of course, we would size it exactly for your finger.
Oh, it's pretty, isn't it, Jack?
Excuse me, sir. Is that your rickshaw outside?
What?
The yellow rickshaw. If you will ask your boys to move it a little to one side, they are crowding the front of the store.
Well, it's not mine. I don't know anything. I don't know anything about it. Kit, do you like the ring?
Oh, I love it, but...
Well, we'll take it. We'll take this one.
Oh, I like to see a man who makes up his mind. You haven't made a mistake.
$500, $600, $700. American dollars. Tell me, is there a back way out of your store?
Oh, why, yes, sir. That door over there.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much. We'll be back for the ring.
Jack, what's the hurry?
Sir, I haven't sized the ring for the young lady's finger.
It was Agnes's rickshaw again. Oh, I don't remember what excuse I made to Kitty for running out that way, but I had to do it. And Kitty never said a word about that day. She went back by herself to have the ring sized. And about a week later, I returned to Lee Yen Street to pick it up for her. And as I came around the corner, there it stood. The phantom rickshaw, and inside it, real enough, was Agnes.
Jack. Jack, dear.
Agnes. No, it's not you.
It's all a mistake, isn't it?
It's my imagination.
An awful mistake. We shall be good friends again soon.
Why are you haunting me like this? You're dead. You brought it on yourself.
Please forgive me, Jack. I didn't mean to make you angry. We will be together always. I know it. You will never belong to another. Never. Never.
She was gone. The coolies, the yellow rickshaw, Agnes, all faded away right before my eyes. Gone like a mirage. Suddenly, the street, Li Yen Street, was as it always was. People, shops. I touched my forehead. It was very hot. I stumbled inside the jewelry store, trying to make sense of what I'd seen. Everything was swimming before my eyes.
How is he, Doctor?
You did the right thing bringing him here to the hospital. Where did you find him?
I didn't. He had fainted at a jeweler's store in town, and the jeweler found Jack's identification card with the U.S. Embassy's number on it. He phoned, and I ran down and brought him to the hospital.
He should be sleeping now. I gave him a sedative. Wasn't making much sense when he talked to me. Kept saying over and over, the yellow rickshaw, or something like that.
The yellow rickshaw? That rings a bell.
Oh, whatever it is, it was enough to cause his mind to turn off all body signals. So he blacked out.
How sick is Jack? What can we expect?
It's impossible to say. A doctor can treat symptoms, but if he's to assist the patient, he must find the causes. Let's see how he handles himself, all right?
Is it all right if I take a look into his room?
Yeah, go ahead. I'll be right behind you. I was coming along to do that myself. Yeah, this is his door. Let's be very quiet. So if he's sleeping, he won't be disturbed.
I'll go in for it. Doctor, Jack isn't here.
He skipped out of the room.
The locker door is open where his clothes were.
Don't know how he did it without being seen. Got up, got dressed, somehow sneaked out of the hospital. Mr. Mylan, have you any idea where he might have gone?
Well, my sister's, or... I'm not sure.
I didn't want to alarm you before, but it's entirely possible that your friend, Jack Pantay, is suffering from some form of schizophrenia.
What does that mean?
A split personality. One leads a life the other doesn't. One sees things the other doesn't. Wherever Mr. Pantay may be, he may not be responsible for his actions.
Not doing so well, are you, Jack? Since you started playing alone.
Agnes, I'm sick. Can't you tell I'm sick?
Because you tried to change your fate. And you can't, Jack. You can't.
Let me alone. Will you go away from me?
Pardon, monsieur. Excuse me, sir. Is there some trouble?
Well, I want a bet. I need the money, but I can't. Bet she won't let me alone.
Who won't let you alone?
This woman standing beside me.
What woman, monsieur?
You're all in league together. You're trying to drive me crazy. But I'm not crazy, and I won't be...
Please be quiet so we can continue,
Yeah,
but no.
I can't help you, sir.
I can't stay here. They're all crazy here. I've got to get out of here. Why is this happening to me?
Jack, you can't run where I can't find you.
Oh, please.
I'll always be with you.
Please.
Look down there in the water, Jack, darling. So black and soft and comforting.
You're destroying me. Go back to the grave, please.
Come into the rickshaw, darling. It's right here. Look. See?
I'm losing my mind. Yes, that's what it is. There's no yellow rickshaw here. Agnes isn't here. It's all in my mind.
We will always be friends. Not even death can stop that. I take you by the arm now. Come along with me.
Oh, let me go. Please. I don't want to go with you. No, 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 don't. Agnes!
I'm glad you got here, Mr. Myland.
I never thought he'd turn up in Macau. It's terrible. I just don't know what to make of it, Doctor.
Well, fortunately, the dock at Macau is well patrolled. So the police got there right away and pulled Mr. Pante out of the water. They put it down to another gambling suicide. An attempt. There are many.
Well, couldn't he have just happened to have fallen in?
It was a surprise to me to see Mr. Pante arrive in a stretcher.
May I go in and see him?
No, by all means. He's not violent. So you've nothing to worry about.
Jack? It's me, Arthur.
Hey, come on in, old buddy.
How do you feel?
Well, silly thing. Imagine an old ferry-goer like me slipping on the dock and falling in.
Is that what happened?
Well, that's what they tell me. Actually, Artie, I don't remember any of it.
Do you remember busting out of this hospital?
You're kidding. Well, yes, I remember being here and then just getting up, getting dressed, and catching the next boat for Macau. I wanted to see some action. Well, I got it all right.
You weren't drinking.
No, I don't think so. But the worst part is, it's all so hazy. I remember backing number 13 on the roulette wheel, and I don't even remember if I won or lost. All I know is being hauled out of the water and flopping around on the dock, these guys bending over me. You know, but I sure won, all right.
You won? How do you know?
Go over to that metal locker set in the wall.
Hmm?
Yeah, that's right. Open it. And you see my pants hanging up all nicely pressed?
Yeah.
Just reach in the left-hand pants pocket. What's there?
A great wad of bills.
Yeah. Do a quick count. Go on.
Great heavens, Jack. There must be at least $10,000 here. Is this yours?
Yeah, the whole bundle. I found it there. That's what I must have won. So you see, Artie, it looks like things are finally breaking my way.
Let's stack the chips and the players. We have Kitty and Arthur Myland, both seemingly sane, normal people. We have Agnes Keith, who may or may not be dead. And we have Jack Pante, insecure, guilty, and clutching at straws. He might try psychoanalysis, but that might not help, as it is confession without absolution. The game continues. Fête Beaujour, join me for the last hand when I return shortly with Act 3. Interesting, isn't it? The self-deception of which the mind is capable. At this point, neither you nor I or Jack Pante can be sure whether Agnes Keith exists anywhere else but in Jack's mind. It reminds us, doesn't it, of that ancient verse, "As I was going up the stair, I met a man who wasn't there. He wasn't there again today. I wish he'd stay away." Let us stay and find out.
Kitty, I think you should seriously consider breaking your engagement to Jack.
What?
Now, hold on a second. Let me explain.
Well, can't I ask how he is?
Yeah, he's still in the hospital.
Was he injured?
He's injured, Kitty, and you know it. How can I put it without hurting you? He's not reliable.
You don't have to say any more. I know what you're going to say. But, you see, Arthur, I love him. And that's all that matters.
It's not all that matters, Kitty. Jack is beset with some kind of a living nightmare.
You mean the yellow rickshaw?
Yeah, and everything that goes with it that you don't know about. Some time ago, long before you arrived here in Hong Kong, he was involved, in a way, with an older woman. He tried to break off with her, and she killed herself.
Oh, I didn't know.
Yeah. And Jack has never been the same since.
Oh, awful for him.
This has preyed on his mind. Has made him sad and desperate.
You think he tried to drown himself in Macau, don't you?
I'm afraid I do. But I'm not the only one who thinks so.
The doctor?
No. the people who run the casino. Whenever someone makes an attempt or succeeds in destroying themselves after having spent time and money at the casino, the owners hustle out, and before anyone knows it, they fill the victim's pockets with money.
Well, that's crazy.
You see, then no one can blame the casino. If his pockets were empty, he could have lost everything gambling and decided to end it all. For a casino, suicide is bad news. Bad publicity.
Oh, I see.
Believe me, Kitty, Jack never won that money. He can't win, and they know it.
I don't care, Arthur. I love Jack, and I know he loves me, and I'll make him forget all past and present things that trouble him. I know I can, and I will.
Of course, I didn't know it then. But dear Kitty believed that if I was unlucky at betting, I should be lucky in love. As soon as I was discharged from the hospital, the council gave me 2 weeks off, and Kitty undertook my renewal.
Oh, Jack, this is a wonderful idea. I just love excursion boats.
Well, you haven't really seen Hong Kong unless you've traveled around it by boat.
I love you when you're like this, darling. So relaxed, sweet. Just you wait and see what I've brought along in this picnic basket.
The boat doesn't stop anywhere. 5 hours of around the island we go.
I know. We'll eat right here on deck. Oh, isn't it getting breezy all of a sudden?
Oh, I'm clouding up.
I've never seen so many little boats all in one stretch of water. What are they called, Jack?
Sampans. The word means three planks. It's about the size of them, too.
That's amazing. How can they move? Like a school of minnows, aren't they, Jack? They're all turning around and heading back the way we came. The clouds came up so fast. It's so dark.
Yeah, it's a little early for tropical storms, but you never know.
What's that?
It's a warning.
Please.
We're turning around, heading back to the pier. Kitty. Kitty, see that dark mass heading right for us?
Yeah.
It's a typhoon. Those who have never been in a tropical storm, there are no words to describe the experience. In spite of the wind, the waves, uprooted trees, flying timbers, and crashing glass, we were able to make harbor. Kitty held onto my hand through it all. But at the very last moment, as hundreds of passengers crowded the gangplanks, I lost her. Now, it was the worst typhoon to hit Hong Kong in 50 years. I searched the pier, the ferry terminal, the streets all night long.
Jack, over here. Jack, do you hear me?
Oh, no. Agnes, my mind is going. That's what it is. I've gone mad. The whole street is a shambles. Wreckage everywhere. People hurt, bleeding. And there you sit calmly in your yellow rickshaw. No, no. No, I am not seeing you. I'm not. I'm not. But I was. I saw her just as clearly as those on the street searching for friends and relatives, just as clearly. Pieces of broken houses lay everywhere. A rubble of glass and bricks and smashed storefronts. And behind me, the sea lurching ever higher, threatening to become a tidal wave. Suddenly, my arm was held onto tightly, and I found myself being dragged along.
Come on, Jack. Thank the Lord we found you. Come with me. Kitty's already in the car.
Oh, Agnes, let go of me. Let go.
Here we are. I found him, Kitty.
No, let me go.
Get into the car, you idiot. I'm taking you home.
I don't want to be in this rickshaw. I don't like it. Agnes, where are you taking me?
Jack, darling, are you all right?
Let me out of here. I've got to get out of this rickshaw.
Jack, sit back and don't talk.
You're dead, Agnes, dead.
Darling, it's me, Kitty. Arthur came all the way to the ferry dock. He found me first, and then you. We're going home.
Don't you understand, Agnes? I don't want anything to do with you. Oh, let me out of this rickshaw. I beg you, please.
Heavens, that's over. I put Jack upstairs and I've locked the door.
Arthur, what can we do about him? A doctor, somebody?
No, we haven't a hope of getting a doctor or even getting him to the hospital. There are badly injured people everywhere.
What's that?
It's him, Kitty.
It's Jack.
Agnes! Agnes, where have you taken me? Let me out of here!
I better go up there and try to reason with him.
This is a nightmare. We're sitting here in the dark with him up there like that.
The power's out all over Hong Kong. Look out the front window. It's black. I don't know when the lights will be turned on again, but, Kitty, keep calm and try not to be nervous.
Oh, there must be something we can do.
I'll go up and talk to him. And Kitty, for your own safety, when I go up, lock this door after me.
All right.
I don't want to take any chances of anything happening to you. Jack? It's me, Artie. Jack, where are you?
It's so dark. Oh, I hate the dark. Oh, who are you? Who's there?
It's me, Artie. Jack, get up off the floor. There's no use just sitting there huddled in a corner.
Oh, Artie. Where have you been? Artie, it's that woman. Agnes. She's got me locked up in here.
There isn't any Agnes. This is my place. I brought you here, took you upstairs. Jack, you've got to convince yourself there isn't any Agnes. Not above Earth. I've seen her grave.
So now you know why marrying Kitty is out of the question.
Okay. You lie down on that bed, will you? I'll open the window. Send in a little air.
You'll tell Kitty, won't you? Explain it to her.
There. Isn't that better?
Oh, did you see her out there? In the street? The yellow rickshaw?
Of course not. Come and look for yourself. See?
Oh, open the window all the way.
Nothing but a couple of dogs in the street. Not a soul in sight.
Oh, you liar. There it is. Right under the window. The yellow rickshaw. I told you. Oh, I've got to go down there.
No, get away from the window, Jack.
I've got to go down there and kill her again.
Huh?
It's the only way. Now, get away from me, Artie. Don't make me do it. I'm sorry. I'm sorry I had to hit you so hard, Artie. But no one's going to stop me now. I climbed out the window and let myself down the drain pipe hand over hand. Only two stories. As I reached the street, the four coolies started off at a trot carrying a yellow rickshaw. Oh, I could see her hand sticking out of it, waving to me to come on. I ran after her.
That's some bruise on the jaw, Mr. Myland. I can give you something for that, but as for having one of our staff help you find him, impossible. We need everyone on deck we can get. Have you any idea how many were injured because of this typhoon?
But he's not responsible, Doctor. I don't know what he'll do.
Go to the police. Give them a description. Tell them where you think he's likely to be hiding. Get their help.
I've been to the police, Doctor. They say it's not their job to go looking for a madman.
I found myself going up the zigzag path to Victoria Peak. And suddenly, the sun rose. And I could see it glowing through the mist. And it came to me. I'd been chasing a shadow. I sat myself in the woods and tried to think of Artie, of my work at the embassy, of Kitty. Good thoughts, sane thoughts.
Are you thinking of me, Jack?
Oh, good Lord in heaven, spare me. Agnes, when will this stop?
Never, Jack. It can't. Because I am part of you. Come with me. I have something inside my rickshaw to show you.
Oh, no, it's up here, too.
Of course, it brought me here. Turn around. I'll climb in first. Take my hand. Aren't you comfortable, dear Jack? Sit closer.
You are real. I can touch you. I thought you must be a ghost. I couldn't understand how you could be alive. Nobody thinks you're alive, Agnes. They read in the papers you'd shot yourself.
Had I shot myself with this?
Yes, that's the pistol. The pearl-handled pistol. So you see, everyone thinks you're dead.
For you, Jack, I am alive.
I don't understand.
For you, I would die. Here, take my pistol.
No, I don't want it.
Take it.
What? are you?
We will always be together. From this very moment, that is our future, our fate.
No, Agnes. No.
It doesn't hurt at all. Let me show you how, Jack.
Party found the body of Jack Pantre, shot through the head, lying face down in the path leading to Victoria Peak. In his hand, a pearl-handled revolver. No one could ever figure out how and where he got it. Jack was mourned by those who loved him. The one bright ray in the tragedy was the knowledge that at last, in death, he was at peace. Or was he? I shall return shortly. Tells us in the Book of Books of a man with an unclean spirit, a man haunted by the past and who lived in a cemetery. And the Lord came to this man and freed him of his unclean spirit and gave him back his right mind. What is your name? Asked the Lord. And the man answered, My name is Legion, for we are many. How many are there today who also cannot rid their conscience of the past? How many would give their very souls to be able to live only in the present? Our cast included Lloyd Battista, E.B. Juster, Gordon Gould, and Ray Owens. The entire production was under the direction of Hyman Brown.
Radio Mystery Theater was sponsored in part by Contact, the 12-hour cold capsule, and True Value Hardware Stores. This is E.G. Marshall inviting you to return to our Mystery Theater for another adventure in the macabre. Until next time, pleasant dreams.